Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Okay, great. You can all hear me. That's nice. So it's a little different today than we're used to. But I wanted to tell you a story before we get going. Story that happened before a while ago. We were just newly married, Antonella and I, and we were moving. We were moving to a small island called Jersey between England and France. And my dad, he helped us pack up the van, all our belongings, and we went to the ferry and we set sail. Well, actually, we didn't set sail because there was a storm, and we couldn't. We had to just sit and wait on the boat for, I think it was about 24 hours. And finally, the sea had calmed down enough that it was safe to sail. And so finally, you know, once we get going, now, it wasn't that the sea was at all, you know, quiet or calm. It was quite still quite lively, and you know, we would look out of the window and we would see the moon, and then the next moment we would see the water as the boat was tipping back and forth. You see the moon, and then you see the water. And that's how we were rocking our way to Jersey. It was, I don't know, supposed to be maybe like 4 hours or something, but it took a lot longer than that. And we chugged along and we were very seasick, and we just stayed in our cabin, and yeah, it was awful. And I really take my hat off to people who work in the sea, you know, as mariners all the time. But as bad as it was inside the boat, I was glad I was not outside of the boat, because being in the storm would mean certain death. So today, we'd like to look at the story of Noah, another boat story. Another story with a storm. And if you Google Noah, you'll get mainly results about the Bible story of Noah, the film Noah with Russell Crowe, and the comedian Trevor Noah. But today we're not going to Google, we're going to look at what the Bible says about this story, and try and find the lessons of what's going on here. Now, Jesus had a few things to say about Noah in the context of telling his disciples when the end of the world would be and the signs that show us when it would be near. In Luke 17, 26 to 30, Jesus said, "And as it was in the days of Noah, so it shall be in the days of the Son of Man. They did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark. And the flood came and destroyed them all. Even thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed." So why should we study the story of Noah? Well, you can think of three things. To teach us how to prepare for the coming storm, as Noah's day parallels our day, to teach us how to live in a society that mocks the God of the Bible, and to teach us how not to give up in reaching people for Christ, especially our families. If you've seen any kind of Bible movie portrayal of before the flood, so anything to do with creation, maybe the Noah's story, you'll see that the landscape is really dry and dusty. But this is not accurate. When God created the earth, everything was good, good, very good. And up until the flood, the earth, the planets, was lush and green, full of animal life, plant life, fruits of great variety. The trees were massive, much like the trees in California, the redwoods, and in Amazon. But there was gold and silver and precious stones in abundance. You didn't need to dig for them like you do today. The people, they would live for hundreds of years, and they had the full capacity of their minds and imaginations to create amazing works of art, architecture, landscape gardens, engineering, and science. But instead of honoring God with all the gifts that they have been given, they worship nature instead of the God of nature or the creator. In Genesis 6, 1 and 2, we read, "And it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born to them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took of them wives of all which they chose." The population of the earth had increased a lot. After all, God had said to the people that they should be fruitful and multiply. Now imagine living hundreds of years, how many children you could actually have. Remember how Adam and Eve's child, Cain, killed his brother, Abel. Cain was then banished and went to start his own tribe, and they left following God to worship idols and even performing human sacrifices, as well as marrying multiple wives. So this is where Genesis 6, verse 5, God said he saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of the heart was only evil continually. Then verses 11 and 12, "The earth was also corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence. And God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted his way on the earth." So if you liked your neighbor's wife or their things, you just go in and take them by force. Violence was glorified. Destroying the life of animals and eating flesh food was common. And sin had become so deep and widespread that God could no longer bear with it. And he said, "I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth." Now, in all of this sin and misery and violence, there was hope. That's where Noah comes into the picture. Noah was of the descendant of Seth, who followed God and kept his commandments and his ways. And I think it's a blessing to be born into a family where your parents or your grandparents have been believers in God. It's a wonderful legacy. And so Noah, it says in Genesis 6, 8, it says, "But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord." And verse 9, "These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a just man and perfect in his generations. And Noah walked with God." So who found grace in Noah? Who said that he was a just man? And who said he was perfect in his generations? God did. So God comes to Noah with the bad news. And this is verse 13 of chapter 6. He says to Noah, "The end of all flesh is come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Make you an ark of gopher wood, and rooms you will make in the ark, and you will pitched within and without pitch. And this is how you should make it. And then verse 22 of chapter 6, it says, thus did Noah according to all that God commanded him, so did he. So here's the first lesson I want to bring out about Noah. Noah was all in. He was all in, right? All that God had commanded Noah to do, he did it. And in the verses before, we see that, or we read that Noah walked with God. In Amos 3:3, it says, can two walk together except they be agreed? So, you know, walking with God means agreeing with him and doing all that he asked you to do. There's a relationship there. But there needs to be that full surrender. It's like you're handing over the keys of your car and letting God be the driver. You remember the rich young ruler who met Jesus? He had kept all the commandments, even from his youth, but he was still lacking. Jesus asked him to sell all that he had, give it to the poor, and come follow him. He had one thing that prevented him from actually giving his all. Today, we have many distractions, social media, music, friends, maybe work problems, toxic relationships, or even our own self-talk. We can't really solve problems, or we can't solve anything, actually, unless we first give our lives to Jesus. It's not good trying to clean yourself up before you go to him, like a baby who's just eaten a blueberry pie and he tries to wipe it off before mommy and daddy sees him. It's impossible. We need to come to Jesus just as we are, however messed up, however bad shape we're in, however we think of ourselves. We just come as we are. He's the one that can fix us, restore us. In Ellen White's commentary in Patriarchs and Prophets, it says about the story of Noah that all that he possessed, he invested in the ark. So Noah didn't just have a theoretical faith. He didn't just believe because that's how he was raised. It was his own decision. He was as solid as a rock. He was all in. You know, when when special forces go on a mission, their leader asks them before they go, have you taken care of everything at home? Everything, anything that could distract them, anything that could jeopardize the focus on the mission they have at hand. And just one unresolved thing could cost them their lives and the lives of their team members. And so the first lesson was that Noah was all in. He did all that he could for as many as he could, for as long as he could, with all that he had. And this was for a God who had made all things for all people and would give all of heaven to save all who were willing. Is everyone still with me? It's hard when there's not the interaction that we usually have. We got an amen from someone.
Amen.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Yeah, it's a different experience not getting that feedback. But we preach by faith, right? Amen. Thank you, Nenad. So the second lesson I want to bring out is to do right. So all in, we're doing right. In chapter 7, Genesis chapter 7, verse 1, and the Lord says to Noah, come thou and all your house into the ark, for I have seen right, you have I seen righteous before me in this generation. Then in our scripture reading, Hebrews 11:7, it talks about how, by faith Noah, being warned of the things he had not yet seen, moved with fear, prepared the ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. Now, the building of the ark was a massive project for Noah, but it was really a faith-building project for him, for his family, for the people that were looking at him and he was preaching to. You probably heard the saying that says, preach the gospel, use words where necessary. Anyone heard that one? So why would you build a massive boat on dry land in a place where it never rained? The answer is by faith. James says that faith without works is dead. It's not enough to say to a starving brother that comes to you for food, God bless you, I will pray for you that someone gives you food, and then send them away hungry. That's not faith. And Noah was a man of faith. He was also a man of action. God told him that there would be a flood. He didn't tell him the exact day or the hour. And Noah, he didn't know what was going to really happen. But he acted and he moved by faith, believing God's word to be fulfilled in his time. And in fact, even when everyone was on the ark, the door was closed, there were 7 days where it didn't rain. And that was a testing time for them as well. But he knew, you know, he stuck it out. So we go on. God told Noah to build an ark. And it's a principle of doing something productive while you wait for something to happen, that you don't really know exactly when it will happen. It's a bit like, have you ever waited for someone and you don't know exactly when they're coming, but you're sort of just looking out the window, looking and checking the door. When are they going to come? When they're coming? And then you say, okay, I'm going to stop waiting. I'm going to read a book or do something, do some cleaning and do something productive while I wait. And then somehow the time goes quicker and you know, before you know it, they're there. In Genesis, it doesn't say that the ark would save him and his family from the planned destruction. But in Hebrews 11:7, it does say that preparing the ark would be the means of saving Noah's family. Like Jonah, who preached to Nineveh for 40 days, they repented and the judgment was averted. God gave Noah's generation 120 years of preaching to give people an opportunity to repent. And that's the key there. The idea wasn't that, you know, trying to get people into the ark. The idea was trying to get people to repent. And they wouldn't need the ark if they had repented, and they wouldn't be needed a flood. You know, God is not willing any should perish, that all would come to repentance. But like when Abraham was interceding on the behalf of Lot and his family to spare the city of Sodom, if there were 10 righteous. God would have spared the city just for 10 people. But there comes a point where there's so few people following God that he has to extract them from the situation. Now, with our preaching, we need to also show people that we really believe what we are preaching. Noah didn't condemn the world through his preaching, but he did it through his action of building the ark. So how did Noah become an inheritor of righteousness? By faith. And from Patriarchs and Prophets, again, it says, page 95, while Noah was giving his warning message to the world, his works testified of his sincerity. It was thus that his faith was perfected and made evident. He gave the world an example of believing just what God says. Now, it's not like we are saved by the works, but our works show people that God has saved us. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, it says, for by grace you are saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. And again, from Patriarchs and Prophets, page 92, all that man could do was done to render the work perfect. Yet the ark could not of itself have withstood the storm which was to come upon the earth. God alone could preserve his servants upon the tempestuous waters. So what is your ark? What is the ark that you're building? We see the signs of the times and believe that Jesus is coming soon, maybe intellectually. But until we start building our ark, we can't show people God and the rest of the watching universe where our heart is. And Jesus said, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So what are we investing in? What is our time, our money, our influence, our talents going into? Do we have a mission, a calling, a work that is the one thing that shows people you believe Jesus is coming soon, as at the same time as you are telling them that he is coming soon? Everything he possessed, he invested in the ark. And again, every blow he struck, every nail he put into the ark was a witness to the people. Now, something that we, each one of us, can build that will prepare us for the turbulent times ahead is our characters, being like Jesus. When people ask us, well, why do you do the things you do? Why do you go to church on Sabbath? Why do you go to prayer meeting? Why do you give 1/10 of your income to support the work of the ministry? You can say, because I believe Jesus is coming soon and I want to be ready. Doing the right thing is this byproduct of connecting with God. As Paul says in Philippians 2:13, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do his good pleasure. Now, if the church were to hire Noah as an evangelist, they might see on his resume, boat builder, preached for 120 years, only 8 responded. Do you think he would get hired? What do you think? At the surface, it seems like it's not a very good resume. But as a parent, I think of it this way. What if 1,000 people are saved for eternity from my effort, but not my children? What's the point for me? As a parent, in a book, Child Guidance, 556, Ellen White talks to parents. She says, to the mother and father, the right training of their children is the most important work of their life. I may build an ark, but if I don't lead my children to worship God and to give their lives to God, then what's the ark for, you know? What is it? What's the point? And so for me, Noah's story inspires me to keep on working on the most important part of my life, to raise my children to love and honor God and give their lives to Him. And if I get to build something and others turn to God, I think, to me, that's a bonus. So I'm just saying it as a parent. And maybe there's parents out there too that feel the same way. So we come to our last lesson from the life of Noah, and that is to keep going. How many of you have ever given an evangelistic series or campaign, or even just one meeting, maybe a weekend series, a month, a year? Who is the oldest here? Maybe there's some people in the 70s, 80s. How about 120 years? That's a long time. That's a long time to be preaching the same message. Like, there's going to be a flood. Everything's going to be destroyed. Need to repent. You know, like, yeah. So Noah, in all of this, he didn't give up. He didn't quit. And he was tested in many, many ways. Some of the obstacles that he was up against, the prevailing unbelief of the people. Do you ever experience people who don't believe the Bible, don't believe about God or spirituality? Rejection from former associates. You know, there were people in Noah's day who they didn't, you know, maybe they used to believe, but the general popular thing was to not believe and to jest and ridicule Noah for what he was doing. There were also people who professed to believe in God and who used idols in their worship. So they had like a mixed worship. How do you deal with those people? Then there were people who dismissed that God would actually punish. You know, he doesn't destroy, he doesn't punish. This is unfair. Those people he had to come up against. And then calling Noah a fanatic and an alarmist. And today, I think there are people who are fanatics. There are people who are alarmists. And then there are people who are not, who are still trying to do the right thing. And there's a lot of confusion around. There were experts and philosophers who said that destruction by a flood was impossible. Maybe that today, you know, people might say, you know, destruction in the by fire, you know, the world as will be one time will be burnt up. That's impossible. The laws of nature are fixed, and God is, you know, he can't change that. And then there were just the general population who wanted to be entertained, who just didn't care about spiritual things. They just wanted to eat, drink, plant, build, and lay plans for the future. So Noah had a lot of things that could have discouraged him, but he stood like a rock in a tempest. And it was his connection with God, who is infinite, which gave him the strength to keep going. He was all in, connected with God. He determined to do right and he kept going. And there are a lot more lessons from this whole story. You can read the story of Noah in Genesis chapter 6 and 7. And also I'd recommend highly the book Patriarchs and Prophets. And it's the chapters 7 and 8 called The Flood and After the Flood. And it's a visually more detailed and way more accurate than any Hollywood movie could ever be. So definitely recommend that if you want to dig in and get the big picture of the story of Noah. So let's wrap it up here and recap our three lessons. And I want to give you a way of remembering these three lessons. In the acronym ARK, ARK, you know, as in Noah's Ark. And I think this even worked it out with Elliot that this works in Swedish as well. So the lesson one was to go all in. That's the A, all in. And lesson two was to do right. And lesson three was to keep going. So ARK, ARK. And as we learned, Noah did all that he could for as many as he could, as long as he could, with all that he had. And if we are to survive the coming storm, the troubles that will come on this earth, we need to be all in, connected with God. There's just no other way of getting around it. You either all in connected, or you're not going to make it. I'm not going to make it. And the second thing, to do right. You know, Noah was declared righteous by God because he believed by faith and acted by faith. And he gave evidence of his faith by building the ark, even though there was never rain and he was building on dry land. He was saved by faith, but worked for the gratitude and love he had to his God. And the last lesson was to keep going. Noah preached his heart out for 120 years, and he didn't stop until the door of the ark was shut. And he never gave up believing. His faith was as solid as a rock. No matter what people said about him, he just maintained his connection. How long have you been a witness for? How many times have you told people about your relationship with Jesus? And I think it's always the hardest to endure at the end of a race than at the beginning. But that's when we need to keep going, keep one step after the other, and endure to the end. So remember, ARK, A-R-K, go all in, do right, and keep going. And I want to make an appeal, actually three appeals today. Have you been putting off going all in? Today is the day. Now is the hour. Don't put it off any longer. Any sin that keeps tripping you up, give Jesus permission to take it away and give your all. I want to ask you if you want to say, yes, I want to go all in. Jesus, take my life, my heart, my future. I want to go all in. If you want to say yes to that appeal, then just indicate somehow. You can put up a thumbs up, or you can, however you want to do it, indicate to God that you want to be all in. The second appeal is, have you struggled to do the right thing Maybe you've been convicted of something that you should be doing. Maybe you want to be more faithful in your tithes and offerings, faithful in keeping the Sabbath holy, faithful in keeping your mind pure and uncorrupted by the things of this world. If you want to say, yes, I want to do the right thing, it's like Noah did. And I want to pray that Jesus gives me the power, the strength and the wisdom to do what is right. If you want to do the right thing, then show your, that's an appeal to you. Right, God bless you. And the last appeal is for those who have been discouraged and feel too tired to carry on. We need to keep going. We need to keep encouraging each other. And you know you can't do it on your own. Reach out to God. Reach out to a brother and sister in Christ and encourage each other. Pray with each other. God is ready with thousands and thousands of promises in his word. And let us not be weary in well-doing. For in due season we shall reap if we faint not. If you say, yes, I want to keep going, just tell God, yeah, I want to keep going. I'm in there. God bless you. Let's pray and close these commitments with a prayer. Father in heaven, we so thank you for the story of Noah. There's so many lessons we can learn, and we just want to focus today on these three. And you've seen the commitments, you've seen the people's needs and the burdens on their hearts. We want to be all in. We want to not hold anything back from you. And like Noah, we know that you will keep us safe in your hands. We also want to do what is right, and we pray that you will give us that power to do what is right, because of the love and the gratitude that we have for you. And we also want to keep going. We want to endure to the end. We don't want to drop out of the race right now at the most critical time. And we pray that you bless your church in Malmo and in Sweden and your faithful people everywhere who are waiting to see you coming back in our lifetimes. And that's going to be an amazing thing. And so we leave all these things in your hands. We know that this is just the first step. This is just the first step of the rest of our lives. And we trust that you will keep us faithful and keep us safe until the end. We thank you and pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.